Isaiah is one of my favorite prophets. God raised him up at a very critical, difficult time in Israel's history. It was a time when Assyria was threatening. Now, Isaiah was in a very unique position. He was the nephew of King Amaziah of Judah. So this put him in a position of having the ear of kings and those who influence kings. But God used Isaiah to speak strong, strong words of judgment. In fact, I am sure that Isaiah's job was extremely difficult. He probably wasn't very popular in many circles. And when we start reading in Isaiah chapter 1, we find things like Isaiah's call, how God said to him, "Isaiah, you are going to be my messenger." We find things that will reflect all the way through his entire career as a prophet. But the first 15 verses of Isaiah 1 are pretty strong, judging words from God against Judah and the leadership of Judah. Even though Isaiah was the king's nephew, I am sure he was not a favorite nephew after the king heard his words. And when we get to Isaiah chapter 1, verse 16, we find the cure for the rebellion that is described in the first 15 verses. So let's read together Isaiah 1, 16 and 17. It says, "Wash yourselves and make yourselves clean. Put away the evil of your doings from before my eyes. Cease to do evil. Learn to do good. Seek justice. Rebuke the oppressor. Defend the fatherless. And plead for the widow." Now, I would like to suggest that we can divide these words into two main categories. The first one I would say is repentance. When Isaiah says, "Wash yourselves, make yourselves clean, put away the evil of your doings from before my eyes, cease to do evil," this is all a call to repentance. God is saying, if you want to be blessed, if you want to have the blessing of doing things my way, then you have to cease doing these things. You need to repent. Now, the word for repentance in Hebrew is teshuvah, which literally means to turn, to change. And in fact, it's like turning 180 degrees and facing the other direction. Now, I've learned since living in Israel that repentance is really not all about turning away from your sin. It's all about turning to God. You know, when we are face to face with God, our sin is left behind. And He is the one who gives us the strength to be able to move forward in a new way, is a new creation, leaving behind our evil ways. And then the next part is what I would call fruits of repentance. When it says, learn to do good, seek justice, rebuke the oppressor. By the way, I think that maybe a better translation there would be relieve the oppressed. And some translations are now translating it that way. Defend the fatherless and plead for the widow. What a terrible state of events Isaiah faced when the people of Israel, the people that were called by God's name, had forgotten how to do good. He says, learn to do good. These were the people that God had called. They were in covenant with Him. They had His word. They had the Bible, and yet somehow they had to learn to do good. Well, you know, in Christianity, we have two ideas about sanctification. One is the sanctification that comes with salvation when we receive Jesus as our Savior. But the second is something called progressive sanctification, and that is the sanctification that comes as believers as we become more and more like our Father in heaven. Well, this is what I think this passage is saying. Turn away, repent, turn to face your God, see who He is, learn His ways, and then walk toward Him, walk in His ways so that we may be like Him. Now, isn't it interesting that when he talks about learning to do good, the next three things that he says is seek justice. So justice, what is justice? Justice is making right things that are wrong. It's wrong to sell women into slavery. It is wrong to abuse children. It is wrong to steal from other people. It is wrong to oppress. It is wrong to enslave people. There are so many things that are unjust in our world today. And learning to do good means that we seek the opposite. We seek justice. Relieving the oppressed, defending the fatherless, and pleading for the widow. Isn't it interesting that God, through the prophet Isaiah, here is defining good as taking care of those in our society that are weak, oppressed, and are unable to care for themselves? The heart of God is for people. Yes, He loves righteousness. He loves goodness. But it's so that the people who need it the most can have justice. That's exactly what we at Bridges for Peace love to do, is we love to help those who need it the most. That's why we reach out and help Holocaust survivors, those who have been cruelly oppressed by evil overlords, and now are in the waning years of their lives. We take them food, but even more than the food, it's sitting and talking with them and laughing with them and listening to their stories and letting them know that they're not alone in this world. That's why we help over 1,000 widows every month with our food programs and hundreds of children, because God has called us as His people to reach out to those who have needs. And He has placed Bridges for Peace in Israel to reach out to His own family, the Jewish people. You know, in Matthew 25, Jesus says that the nations will be judged by how they treat those in need. I want to be a Matthew 25 believer, someone who the Lord looks at and says, when you blessed those people, when you fed them, when you clothed them, when you visited them in prison, it was as if you did it unto me. Let's step into God's blessing column. Let's not go down the curse path. We always have a choice. We can choose blessings or cursings. So today, I choose God's path of blessing. I choose to turn away from evil. I choose to do good, and I choose to love and care for those in need. God bless you from Jerusalem.